bringing crime, they're rapists, and some, I assume, are good people.
You can do anything. Grab him by the pussy.
I can do anything.
We're going to bring jobs back. We're bringing jobs back to our country. We're not going to let Carrier leave.
It became clear that the best way to stay competitive and protect the business for long term is to move production from our facility in Indianapolis to Monterrey, Mexico.
They had a gentleman worker, he was on, and it was like he didn't even know they were leaving. He said something to the effect, no, we're not leaving, because Donald Trump promised us that we're not leaving. And I never thought I made that promise. Not with Carrier, I made it for everybody else. I didn't make it really for Carrier.
Within 24 hours, I'll get a call, the head of Carrier, and he'll say, Mr. President, we've decided to stay in the United States. All right, this is gonna happen. 100%.
And this is, make no mistake, this is a repeal and a replace of Obamacare. Make no mistake about it. Premiums will be coming down. Deductibles will be coming down. But very importantly, it's a great plan. And ultimately, that's what it's all about. Immigration is the fault in all of the problems that we're having. They could be murderers and thieves and so much else. So we want a safe country. And it starts with the borders. And that's the way it is.
These are children who were brought to this country, no fault of their own. This is the only country that they know. We should not send them out of our country. We need to make sure they're taken care of.
That we move forward with retaliatory measures on July 1st, applying equivalent tariffs to the ones that the Americans have unjustly applied to us. I have made it very clear to the President that it is not something we relish doing, but it is something that we absolutely will do, because Canadians were polite, were reasonable, but we also will not be pushed around.
Sometimes we disagree, but we always speak and share, I think, common concerns and common values.
Russia should be in this meeting. Why are we having a meeting without Russia being in the meeting? We had a good chemistry. I don't know if that's supposed to be popular or politically correct to say, but we really did. We had good chemistry. He's the head of a country, and I mean, he is the strong head. Mm-hmm. Don't let anyone think anything different. Right. He speaks and his people sit up at attention. I want my people to do the same. There is nobody that respects women more than I do. I'm sorry. If I had my daughter, perhaps I'd be dating her. You gotta watch your CNN. I mean, what a fraud it is.
I would build a great wall, and nobody builds walls better than me, believe me. I'm really rich. I'll show you that in this. Then I'll be the best in jobs by far. I will be the greatest that God ever created, believe me.
I will be the greatest jobs president that God ever created. I tell you that. I'm very highly educated. I know words. I have the best words. Ka-ching, ka-ching, ka-ching.
Boom, bing, bing, bing. Oi.
Wah.
Bing, clink. Hello.
Bye.
We remain a young nation. But in the words of Scripture, the time has come to set aside childish things. in reaffirming the greatness of our nation. We understand that greatness is never a given. It must be earned.
Tonight is a night for rejoicing, because as Dr. King said, as Dr. King liked to quote, the moral arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, tonight in this time, in this place, you helped bend that moral arc. You sent it right through the heart of the great state of Alabama.
It took a little longer than we thought, but we did it. You did it. You did it. You did it. People want to be heard. They want to talk about serious things and honest solutions, not be drowned out by dark money, distorting the truth and telling lies to our children.
Thank you, Madison County. What happened tonight is amazing. I couldn't be more honored and more humbled to be standing here tonight as your nominee.
The time has come to reaffirm our enduring spirit, to choose our better history, to carry forward that precious gift, that noble idea passed on from generation to generation, the God-given promise that all are equal, all are free, and all deserve a chance to pursue their full measure of happiness.
To get anyone but Mimi, anyone who would stand up for our Orange County families elected. Thank you for what you did. For those of you who have not been refreshing the election results in quite the same way that they've been doing it in the 48th district, I hope that I can be the bearer of good news for some of you. Mimi Walters earned 51% of the vote. To put that election cycles, the Republican share has never fallen below 60. And that is fast change. And we knocked. And we called. You knocked. And you called. And we reached out in our campaign. We knocked on 100,000 doors. We called some of you again and again and again to make sure you showed up to vote. And the campaigns of my fellow candidates did the exact same thing. And that's what it's going to take to win this seat. We're going to talk about the values that we share as Orange County families, but our biggest challenge is waking up our friends and neighbors to who is failing Orange County today. Because the conversations we have with Republicans, with no party preference voters, with those who, I let my registration lapse a few moves back. Those folks, when they heard about me and they heard our message of standing up for health care, of standing up for education, of standing up to powerful special interests, they turned out to vote. So we have a big fight ahead of us, but it's because there are so many of you in this room tonight and so many of you who worked so hard in the last 14 months to get here that we are positioned to flip this seat. And I really want you to hear me. We are in the position to flip the seat. Because this is the time that we do this work. The single most common question I get asked in Orange County, out of Orange County, is that Mimi Walters is so terrible, how did she get elected? It's a pretty good question. Now, if I don't have a lot of time, I say something like this. Well, as Elizabeth Warren likes to say, she fell uphill. The longer story is one about us. Not the us in this room, but all of us in the 45th district. Needing to have these hard conversations about why votes matter. Why what happens in Washington is going to make sure and make a difference in whether our kids are safe in school. Whether we have health care that we can afford to get when we need it. Whether we face the consequences and the sticker shock of a tax plan that only singles out Californians and attacks homeowners at a time that affordable housing is a crisis in California and right here in Orange County. What happens in Washington matters in Orange County. And that's the message that's going to help us win this election. We are so excited about all the momentum that has come since June. Dave, Brian, and Kia have been nothing but supportive, and I am so grateful to them. And I am so excited about the partnerships that we are already building. Folks around the country are looking at us. They're not just looking at me, they're looking at us to say, can we take back the House? Is the orange curtain real? And we know it's not, but that's our task to make it true, to make it happen, to get those votes out that we're going to need. So we're gonna be talking about Mimi Walters' record every day between now and November 6th. We're gonna talk about her support for a tax plan that punishes Californians. We're gonna talk about her A-plus rating from the NRA. We're gonna talk about her calling for more drilling off our beaches. We're going to be calling her out on her vote to take away health care and rip away protections for pre-existing conditions. We're going to talk about her 24 votes to restrict a woman's freedom to make her own reproductive choices. When we talk about these issues, we win. And that's the work that we've been doing. We have been doing, and that's the project that we're going to keep doing every day between now and November 6th. I could not be here, we would not be here, without every person in this room. whoever you supported in the primary, I say to you, God bless, and let's go forward and kick Mimi Walters.
Yeah.
Questions and give a chance to talk with you. It's been a really exciting couple weeks on the campaign. Lots of great things have happened. I have some friends I didn't know I had, which is super awesome. And so my phone is the voicemail. If you've been trying to reach me, I apologize, because the voicemail is just full all of the time. And so thank you for your patience. Thank you for asking for yard signs. And I'm on Erica every day about where is the stuff that we need to do. So it's coming. This is Erica, my manager. Want to be at Ground Zero in Orange County. So Julian will be in touch with you guys and continuing to help you. And Kelsey is back there. Kelsey helps us raise to date, can I say? Yeah. $1.65 million. Trust me, my office is literally a closet. The money we raise goes to communicating with voters. And that's where your time and your talent and your resources will make all the difference. If we get our message out, we win. And so Kelsey's back there. If you're able to contribute, please do. Any amount makes a difference. Right now, and I'll take questions, right now, we'll stage the campaigns at, is we're on the map. When I am declared in this race, I knew Mimi was. I'm running out of words. I knew Mimi was trouble. What I didn't know was how contested this seat would be and how it would fit into the national landscape. And so we've been talking with folks all over the country who are saying, "Where you want to come to Orange County and knock on doors with you." Wow. We're going to help communicate with voters. We'll help fund that message. We'll send a mailer. Sierra Club. We'll send a mailer to our Sierra Club members. We'll help them get out the message on Mimi's terrible record on the environment. So those conversations are really, really important because we need all the resources we can get. For those of you who haven't seen it, Mimi Walters, and this icon, I'm not the only candidate in the country this has happened to. 3 or 4 days after the primary, Mimi Walters was up on TV hitting us. Do you want to know why?
Scared, right?
Because we're winning! She's scared, and I even heard someone put an adjective after that. She's scared. Alright? So that's the good news. So what we have to do is keep making sure that we get the word out that we can flip the seat. Because our biggest obstacle is getting voters to understand that their friends and their neighbors, their co-workers, share their values. There are a few of you in this room who said, "Well, I'll walk my precinct, but it's only me and like this one lady I know who doesn't like home." And then they showed up to walk their precinct and said, "I didn't sign up to knock on everybody's door." And we said, "No, you're just knocking on And they said, my God, I gotta go home and put on tennis shoes. I didn't, like, they had no idea. So for those of you who don't know, how many Republican percentage in this district? 38%. But tell everybody you know. Tell your Republican friends, you're in the minority. Come on over. 38%. And we reached out to some of those Republicans, and a lot of them are concerned about Means voting record because of the way it's gonna hurt Orange County families and the things that we care about. So we are really excited about communicating with more voters. We cannot wait to get our field office up and running. We're hiring more people right now. But this is the moment, this is the time, this is our year to turn Orange County blue.
Start with Bettman, because it's basically within a week of when school starts, because these social, the senior teachers do a voter registration drive, but they do it in the spring. You need to get them, because there's about 25% of the students who are enrolled as seniors are already 18, and maybe higher, and they need to know that they need to be registered. And the suggestion is that they sign up as permanent absentee voters, because when they go off to college, they can still vote here.
Yep. No, that's the question. Everybody hear the question? It was about how to reach out to the importance of reaching out to high school students. I would say we also really need to reach out to our community college and college students. UC Irvine's Republican club is bigger than its Democratic club. That's not about the values of those students. That's about the hard work that we need to do organizing.
Yeah.
So I have it right on my radar. First day of school in Tustin Unified, August 15th. First day of school in Irvine Unified, August 23rd. I'm on it. Partners in voter registration with some wonderful nonpartisan groups like the League of Women Voters. That's where they can be really helpful, is working on voter registration, because they're nonpartisan, and then they can take that off us so we can devote our resources to persuasion. So those partnerships are everything. In the back. Yep. In the paper. So I'm a professor, so I tend to wander. I'm really sorry. I'll go back to the front.
I'm a lab boy. So there was a lot of talk about a disappointing turnout in the primary.
Wrong!
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. We think all of
them. I'd love to hear what your take was on turnout and what sort of the top expectations are for the November.
Absolutely. So on election night, we talked about this. Erica would come out. She took a little sip of water from the same water bottle, and then she'd refresh, and then she'd come out and tell me how we were doing. We were having a great party. Erica was like literally like having a heart, like seriously heart palpitations. And I remember saying to Erica, house turnout? And she said, typical. But what happened in this election was so many more people voted by mail, and that's been a trend, but it's a trend that just went up. And there was a lot more clarity this year around the fact that you could postmark it on election day. That had not been clear before. And so the number of votes that came in, so for those of you who weren't watching Erica, I think Mimi Walker started at something like 54%, above 54. She's now down at 51.7. So that drop off, those are all the people who are vote by mail, but they took their ballot in that day. They're the procrastinators. We call them Democratic persuadable voters. They mailed their ballot in on election day. It was postmarked on election day. It was received in time. So total turnout, I believe, was right around 170, 160, something like that.
About a little over 40%.
Yeah, so a little over 40% of the eligible voters voted. Now we all say, well, what about the other 60? Right? That's where the work ahead comes. But let's be clear. The 40% who voted in the primary, people who vote in primaries in a given year tend to go on into the general. That's why it really matters. That's why I'm so grateful to have had such an amazing field of candidates. Because if those people vote in the primary, they will vote in the general. So nobody knows turnout in the general. If Erica knew that, she'd leave me. She'd be working for some, I don't know, other campaign. So we don't want that. So we don't know for sure, but look, based on what we've seen in primaries around the country, it is looking like it will be high. Okay? Our challenge is pure turnout helps, but the habits of Orange County will lead them to vote Republican if we haven't done our persuasive work. If we haven't been up on TV, if we haven't been calling voters, if we haven't been mailing, if we haven't been having events, then the habit of just turning out more folks won't necessarily help us. Yep.
So we have to find a strategy for young families, because I know so many young people who have two jobs and two kids and they just didn't get around to voting.
Oh, absolutely.
We've got to find a way to get to them to help them to vote.
So look, those of you who don't know, I'm a working mom of three young kids. They are six, about to be 10 and 12. They are the best campusers in Orange County. No offense, Julian. And so I'm only one sick kid away on any given year, or one cranky tantrum away from not getting to the polls. So I understand. So part of this is about making sure people know they can sign up for permanent absentee ballots and having that conversation. So that's one of the first things we want to encourage people to do. And a lot of our strategy that I think was very effective for us wasn't, we didn't just, some of you got these profile calls, some of you. I called some of you. It wasn't just, will you vote for me? We then sent you a letter. We then called you again to make sure you were still gonna vote for me. Then we called to make sure you had voted for me. And if you hadn't, we asked you, could I help you vote for me? Like, what is it you need to get to the polls? And so it takes more than one door knock and someone saying, yeah, you have my support. It takes that whole, that's what really strong appeal looks like, is that whole process from introducing yourself and getting them to say, oh, look at this flyer, all the way to ballot in. If you stop halfway and the ballots don't come in, that's the problem. So
I challenge everybody to babysit with some young family so that they can even have the time to go into another room and vote.
Yeah, no, it's very, very hard. And so permanent absentee ballot, we also, we can, as a campaign, we can pick up ballots. So one of the most effective things we do, and Erica will talk about this as the time comes, I'm gonna take some other questions, but it's saying to people, what's your plan to vote? Well, I plan to go first thing in the morning. Okay, is there anything that might go wrong that might stop you from getting there? Oh, well, gee, let me name the ways. We could run out of Cinnamon Toast Crunch, we could miss the bus, somebody could let their bed, I mean, who knows, right? And so having those conversations is really, really important. But this is where our Secretary of State and Neil Kelly are working hard. The early voting centers, did anybody vote that way besides me? I didn't. So the early voting centers are something that didn't have as many folks. There's a lot more potential there. And so that way, when the kids are behaving, you can take them. You don't have to hope that they behave on November 6th. Okay, in the back.
And even better to take the kids with you.
Yes.
No, I'm
So the question was, do we have talking points on our website so you know how to communicate with voters to persuade? The answer is, there is some stuff on the website. One of my questions to Erica was, where are we on the website? So we're going to be working on it, but we will have lots and lots and lots of trainings and information. But I also want to say the single most important thing you can do right now is educate people a little bit on just name recognition, on what Mimi's doing that's upsetting or hurting to you and your family. So saying to someone, I'm worried about gun safety, are you? And if they say yes, saying, well, part of the reason I'm worried is because we have a congresswoman who stands by and supports the NRA while our kids and teachers are dying. So that's where I would suggest you start any conversation, is around an issue that's important to you. But we'll get you everything you need, but we are working as fast as we can to get everything you need. So I appreciate all of you who have written to us and volunteered. We haven't lost anybody. We're gonna get to you. But we are literally, we literally have to like vacuum. Like on the agenda is deep cleaning the field office. Some of you saw it at the end, it was a little, not up to my standards of tidiness, so we'll get there, I promise. promise. We'll get you all the punch you need. I mean, go to Toronto and come back with everything.
I think people will vote if they have an issue that they care about. So I want to know what issue you're projecting, because when, for the primary, for the elections that went, I didn't know anything about the candidate. Mm-hmm. I just watched the ads and made my decision. So if I would vote if there's something I care about. But if they don't care about any of the issues, there's no amount of knocking on doors is going to get them to vote.
Yep.
So I want to know what issue you are emphasizing.
Yep.
Because voting against meaning waters is not going to get you out of it.
So I mentioned some of them again. Okay, I mentioned some of them earlier, but I'm going to repeat them right now. And let me say that we're working, like, this takes building out. Because one of the things that we learned in this race is that the no-party preference voters in a 45th district are quite different from the no-party preference voters, for instance, in the district that Katie Hill, they call us the Katies, who is running north of LA. So in our district, 17% of the no-party preference voters identified as conservative. In Katie Hill's district, which is California, just north of LA, Antelope Valley, Santa Clarita, like 70%+ of her no-party preference voters identified as conservative. All right, so making sure you understand your district and what to talk about. But the big issues we're going to talk about is Mimi's vote on the tax bill, punishing Californians, singling us out to pay more than our fair share when we're working hard to fund our schools and other things with our state and local taxes, the homeownership effect of the tax bill. Gun safety, huge issue. Really a big one to turn out, particularly younger voters, women voters, moms, grandparents. That is a really big one. Healthcare, the top polling issue among no party preference voters in the 45th district is Medicare for all.
So is that the issue you're pushing?
Well, so we won't have just, so the way to win is you have your issues. You don't walk along. Those of you who know me, I don't do a lot of walking. I have pretty firm opinions. You don't waffle on your issues, but you do choose the issue that you reach out to voters on.
Right.
So not everybody is going to get the exact same message. Everybody is going to get a message that I truly believe in. But not everybody will get the same message. And so we'll target different voters with different kinds of messages that we think they'll be most responsive. And we'll reach them in the way that they're most likely to respond. So if you're trying to reach someone who's 25 years old, mailing them something, not a very good strategy. Okay? If you're trying to reach voters who are 75 and have limited mobility, mail is excellent. Mm-hmm. Right? So we'll have different messages, but every message will be one that I believe in. And that was absolutely true in the primary. Okay, somebody in the middle here, we have a question.
Is there any chance that televised the game?
Oh, the question was, is there any chance of a local televised debate? So I'll just say this. I went and the National Democratic Party wanted to give me some training and talking to media. This is very helpful because we're going to get a lot of reporters. I mean, we had a New York Times reporter following me around all day on Election Day, which is great. And we made page A13. She'll never agree. So if she does, we'll be ready. But I think the odds are approaching zero. Okay.
Have I taken a position
on impeachment? And the answer is no, because we don't have, as a regular citizen, just like you guys, I don't have access to the information that I would need to make that decision. I absolutely support the independent counsel, and that should not be a part of the meeting. The special counsel and the independence, the work that the Department of Justice does, that's about protecting the pillars of our democracy. And we start knocking those down at our grave peril. And that is exactly what the video highlighted is going on right now. Mm-hmm. So the answer is, if I get there, when I get there, when we see the evidence, if we see the evidence, then I'll do what I think the law requires. And I won't be afraid to do it. But right now, I know no more than any of you guys do. Okay, JP, and then we'll go over here. Yeah.
I'm waving my hand.
You already answered it. We've got the debate.
Okay, super. I mean, I wish. Like, did you see how many of them meet me? So I just want to tell you, my story of Mimi. So her name is Mimi, this one in the front row. Actually, her name is Mimi. So I was me, and I was at one of many Memorial Day events that I went to. And Mimi Walters was at one. My spotted her. And she was given a really important job, the Pledge of Allegiance, which I thought was for the Tiger Scouts. And that's what Mimi was given. She was there, and after the event, I went rushing up to her, and I waited my turn, and I said, "Hello, Congresswoman Walters. I'm so excited to meet you. I'm Katie Porter." And I'll just say, she didn't share my sunny disposition. She literally was like, she's making the eyes of her staff up. She just fled. So I don't think we're going to have a debate. I very much hope we do. And so because we're not going to have a debate, because we don't have a lot of media coverage here, we don't have local TV, for example, that means the TV, the mail, the door knocking, the phone calling are even more important because we don't have as much media that we can rely on to get the message out. Okay. Yeah.
Ms. Ward? So I guess I'm interested in something that's probably different from a lot of other people. I'm a college student at Pomona, and I want to be a dentist. I guess for me, it's easy for a lot of Democrats, candidates, to just say the name is horrible. But I'm interested in what you want to do. So if you're elected, and I hope you do, and the majority is still on the public side, I don't want my fellow students or I to wait for another 2 years, for 4 years, for people to solve issues like student debt. I want to have someone in DC who would make the necessary compromise and talk to the right people. It's easy to say no to Trump, we can all do that, but I would like you to let me know, to convince me that you're different from a lot of other Democrats. You actually want to get something done. And that's what I want to know as a student, because yep. A lot of issues don't just go away because many people start them.
They need more. So, thank you. And I'm going to talk about the internet, which is so many things. So, first, I very much hope we're not in the minority. I really don't think we're going to be. But whether we're in the majority or the minority, you still, when you're in Congress, should try to persuade everybody to create the biggest consensus you can, to have the best conversation you can, to pass legislation or changes that are going to work for Americans. So if you, there's no, just like we're saying, we reach out to every voter we could. We didn't just knock on the doors of Democrats, we knocked on the doors of other persuadable voters. I would say the exact same thing. And one of the things that you might take heart from is that when I worked with the big banks, against the big banks, I had great relationships with those bankers and with those banking leaders. So I would say to them, look, you agreed that you were going to send this letter within 5 days, acknowledging that a homeowner needed help. And you're not doing it. And we're getting lots of complaints. Here are some of the examples. For most people, that's where the conversation ended. Here's a problem. You caused it. You go fix it. Well, what we did is say, why is this happening? Is it that your technology isn't good? Is it that is it the personnel? Is it staffing levels? What is the lever that we need to pull to change this? So with student loan debt, part of the conversation has to be helping people understand that student loan debt is not a young people's issue. Student loan debt is holding back our entire American economy. And so that is a conversation that everybody, every American, pro-business, Republican, conservative Americans, ought to care an awful lot about the opportunity that young people have to save for retirement, to buy their first home, to pursue higher education. So that's the way I would approach that, is just saying, look, we all benefit by having affordable college. It's not like Republicans go tuition free, right? So the problem with college tuition and college debt is not one that is a partisan issue, and we just shouldn't talk about it that way. So I think part of it is not letting them paint these things as our issue or your issue. They are our issues. And that's how I think we're really, that's how we talk to voters at the door, and I think that's how we're going to win in November, not just here, but hopefully around the country. So, the gentleman, the
yeah, the question I have, I was a blind voter supporter. Mm-hmm. Probably the greatest moment for me as a Democrat was to get an email from Ryan a couple days later. Really said, you know, that we lost, blah, 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 thank you for the support, et cetera. But then said, now we roll up our sleeves and support Katie Ford. I do call Mimi's office every so often. I don't know, they're crazy, my number or something, so I call my business phone, my cell phone. My name is Guillermo, so I sound Bill. So I do all the tricks to make a
point. Try Roger Republican.
But the interesting thing about the whole thing is, when I called the other day, and I asked a specific question whether or not Mimi supported the discharge petition to put some of the immigration bill on the House floor. And the person on the other side of the phone said, let me check. Came back 30 seconds later and said, yes, she did. When I knew that she didn't. So there's lying going on in that office. I'm telling you that I heard it. I can attest to it. One other thing I'll just recommend to the people here, to keep up with the issues, which I usually do, there's a web called Countable. C-O-U-N-T-A-B-L-E, Countable. And Countable feels free to go to a Countable, I don't know, it's an app. You get it, and they track every vote of every person. We're in the 45th, so I get to leave the wall, go up this morning, we can vote on some issue. You'll get the vote. You'll get an explanation, the pro, the con, and then the vote of the person. So I recommend to stay on top of things. Do Countable. It's a really helpful.
Let me just say one really quick thing, and thank you for sharing both of those things. One of the things, I encourage you guys to keep calling me. I recently wrote with Planned Parenthood, wrote on the card, I am a patient. Do not take away my health care. Do not take away my cancer screenings, right? So keep talking at, if you can, to Mimi's office, because the consequences, even in the next 18 weeks, are too high for us to stop. Okay, so stay on it, stay with it, even though I'm not optimistic. She's going the wrong direction. For those of you who have been following her, her voting with Trump is going up, not down. But their consequences are high if we don't stick with it. Real people are being hurt every day, and we know that all too much with the news of the last couple of weeks. Okay. And we'll get to it. The question was about engaging millennial voters, not necessarily students, but those who have graduated. They're a hard group to reach because they're working. They're not all, you can't go to the campus, okay? So one way to reach them, like you said, is through their parents, through their grandparents. We have a lot of people who said, I like you, I'm gonna vote for you, I'm gonna make sure my kids vote for you. And that was very, very helpful. We did a video with a group called Now This. How many kinds are there? I mean, a lot. Like a frightening number. So we also have very strong digital presence, and that's very important. But the digital is targeted, again, different sites and different people see different things to try to make it resonate. So we're going to continue to put resources into that and to broaden that out. But the more millennials are the toughest group. The best way to reach them is, again, on issues. We know that millennials who are registering to vote today in California are not registering as Democrats. They're also not registering as Republicans. So what that says is the brand, either party, isn't carrying a lot of weight right now with millennials. And that's something we have to work to change. But in the meantime, the best way to approach a millennial is, like I said, with most voters, is around an issue they care about. And so we were doing some of that. Erin, did you find that video?
What is that? A little over 18,000 views.
Yeah, so 18,000 views on this video would be considered. But that's I'm like, what is this? Because I'm 44, right? Erica's like, it's the greatest thing. I was like, I never heard of it. So we were on Young Turks. We've been doing some things that we know have particularly high following. Millennial voters are a challenge, which is we want them all to vote. We have some great partners with that. Next Gen America is doing work to turn out the millennial vote. So there are a lot of groups that we're going to be focusing on that. So to the best of my knowledge, I've never heard the question was, is it true that Mimi Walters does not live in the 45th district? To the best of my knowledge, Mimi Walters lives outside the 45th district. I have heard that she lives in Laguna Beach. I believe she has never lived within the boundaries of the 45th district. So the question was, how does that work? So the answer is, for federal Congress, you have to live in the state. You don't have to live in the district. So she's not doing anything illegal. She's just doing something wrong. And when you pair that with her unwillingness to meet with us, her unwillingness to come out and engage in events, the way she treats folks who go to her office and the kind of letters that she sends back to us, that's reflective, I think, of the larger problem that Laura was talking about, right? That she's just disengaged.
For the sake of devil's advocate, I'm curious. I feel like you're really going to have to build some consensus. That's very important in this campaign of devising forces of working. So, what are some traditional Democratic issues, platforms that we know that you feel, if you went into this kind of related to that gentleman's question, that you feel you could give and take a little, either for us when we're knocking on doors to be able to have someone not slam the door, and also yourself, can you think of some issues that it would be? I assume Democratic platform you might be able to give a little off.
Yeah. So, I mean, look, I think there are any number of issues where this is true, but I think part of it is, I think it's reframing, and I said this before, but it's reframing the conversation around what is the actual shared goal. So, I don't think you're going to meet a lot of voters who say, I like unaffordable health care. That's not what they're saying. They're saying, I'm scared that if we change it, it will get worse. And they have some reasons to fear that, right? And so I think it's trying to figure out what is it that they're worried about and what is it that we need to say and can do when we're in Congress to give them that confidence that Washington's going to work for them. I think one of the most important things you can talk about is campaign finance reform, and that this campaign and how it's funded should give people confidence that I'm committed to working for the families of the 45th district. And the businesses of the 45th district, and their economy in the 45th district, but not for any one donor or any one special interest. And so that is a lot of people, whether they disagree with you on an issue, if they feel like you are genuinely a member of their community and are willing to listen to them and respectfully agree to disagree, that's actually enough. And so there'll be those moments in Congress. So I think there's a lot of room for bipartisan cooperation on foreign affairs. This is an area that has not traditionally been as Trump has taken us with his diplomacy by tweet to a place that we have not been before in this country, where our allies do not know if they can count on us. And that is a terrible, terrible situation. It's destabilizing not just us and our safety, but the safety of so many around the world. And so I think really standing up for the diplomatic corps is an issue, for instance, that we have to do. Standing up for science and basic science research. Huge. Everybody wins when we invented Velcro. That was NASA. They invented Velcro because they didn't want stuff to float around. We all like Velcro. So talking about investments in basic science, infrastructure, jobs, that we need to create the infrastructure that we need. There are plenty of issues that we can reach across the aisle on. And I think we're going to elect enough new folks to Washington with a different kind of energy and attitude that I hope we can reset some of those conversations. I think it will be hard with Trump, to be honest with you, but I think we can start down that path and then and move forward much more quickly after 2020.
We've talked about branding. How both brands get weaker. We talked about the issues that you're going to talk on micro-targeting, pick groups and you'll send your message. But what are you going to do about the problem with my Democrat? I'm a lifelong Democrat. Because we're failing. And what are you going to do when you talk to your people up in the national to get somebody here and now that's going to say enough? You know, you showed Obama, and we all, a lot of us, I assume, don't really know about that. There's no Obama right now. Zero. We suck. What do you do about that?
So, I think it's really important. I'm not going to debate the problem with you, but I am going to tell you, that is a rabbit hole on which I can't go down. The way we're going to persuade voters in the 45th district is talking about the things that we've been talking about tonight. I think the short answer for me is if they ask me, would you like to run the Democratic National Party? No! No, I would not, right? But I think we're seeing in some of these races around the country, voices, authentic, passionate voices, that are talking about the issues in a fresh way, in a way that is moving and engaging people. And I think we see the best way to illustrate this is the huge movement we've had in conversation just in the last 6 months around gun safety, right? And so there's much more of that needs to happen and to come. I'm not a pundit, I'm not a political consultant, I'm a consumer protection attorney, it's true. I'm a law professor, I'm a mom, this is how I think about myself. So the Democratic Party's national message, that's the Democratic Party's problem.
So that's the thing I wanted to just share with you, is that when I get asked for money, okay, I've written back to the DCCC, I'm not going to give you guys any more money. If you're telling me that you want to spend money in another district to promote a Republican, you know, that's throwing good money after bad. You know, have somebody that we believe in. Don't spend money. So the reason I'm sharing that with you, the reason I give you money is because of Elizabeth. That's it. But you talk about spending money and putting on a million and a half. I'm worried about the leverage because there is a problem, and I really invite you to talk to people at the national, which is, what are we going to do to create leverage? And because I don't watch them. I don't watch them. A lot of my friends don't. Okay, because Trump sucks the air. So, please talk to your next group. I'm worried about the leverage of the money that you have.
Yeah. So, the money that we raise in this district, we spend in this district. Okay? All of it. All of it. It funded the phone calls, it funded the door knocking, it funded the rent, it funded the mail, it funded the TV ads. So, thank you. And if you don't want to give to DCCC, please give to Kelsey. She's very fast. Processing your credit card. But you know, we have to keep our message authentic to who we are. So what I said to you about who the voters are in Orange County, you guys are here because you're very engaged, you're very informed. And you've been working on this, some of you for your whole life, some of you for months. When I told you there were 38% Republicans in the district, a lot of you were surprised. Right? And so we win when we know who we are. And you get there by living in the community. Right? By being a Cub Scout volunteer, by being a mom, by going to people's houses in their backyards, that's how you get there. So know that every dollar you give to fund our campaign stays with our campaign to talk about the issues that matter in the 45th district. I fear no response.
One more question.
You do that and everybody's hand goes up.
I know.
This
lady right here in the white.
Okay.
I've been doing a lot of crime. I've been doing a lot of eating chocolate. Because if I say I'm not going to watch, then I feel I'm complicit.
Right.
go and I play Hearts Online, AOL. On that game that I play, there's something called SoCal Daily.
Yes.
Media. Oh, yes. It's got a picture of Amy Walters, and it keeps on playing five or six different points of why she was awful. They hit home, they make sense to me. But what I'm missing, and what everybody is missing, how do we get you out there too?
Yep.
It's, it's one thing to have nails in the cross. You've got to know your name more. Your ads in the primary.
Yeah. I can tell you my whole big part of that. Want to hear it?
Sure.
I'm Katie Porter, and I approve this message. I approve this message. I can tell you whichever you want. But listen, so that is about resources, right? And so we will, and so we have a plan about how and when we'll roll out, and ramp up, right? So what we don't want to do is spend $500,000 in July. When what everybody wants to do is figure out where the cheapest crayon, or August, when everyone wants to look for the cheapest crayons at Target or whatever. We're gonna reach people when they're at the persuadable moment. All right, so that starts now with laying the foundation, with raising the resources, with building and training the volunteer corps, with hiring the staff, with creating the national partnerships. But we'll be there, don't worry. And our partners are gonna be there with us. All the groups that care about the issues that we've been talking to tonight are going to be there with us. So, absolutely. All right. Thank you so much. Kim Donahue and I talked about